There's always something happening on AM 1460 WVOX.
That's my station.
1460 WVOX. Making this get ready to hear the voices of the future. Spread the love and sunshine. Here's Future Talk with Jack and Louise.
Hello, all you WVOX listeners out there. Welcome to Future Talk with
Jack
and Louise. We have a very special episode planned for you guys today. So today on Future Talk, we have a very special guest, award-winning New York Times best-selling British novelist, AJ Hartley. AJ is also a Robinson Professor of Shakespeare at the University of North Carolina. He's written many books spanning many different genres, such as mystery slash thriller, fantasy, historical fiction, as well as young adult novels. Welcome to Future Talk, AJ. Is there anything we missed in our introduction that you want to tell the audience?
No, I think that's a pretty good list, yeah.
So, AJ, what motivated you to become a writer in the first place? Were there any authors or books that inspired you?
Yeah, I mean, I grew up in a sort of working class industrial town, and a lot of people didn't have a lot of great opportunities in terms of future employment and stuff. And I think I got into books because it became a sort of an escape for me. You know, I mean, as a reader, just to sort of get into my imagination, and connect with other people's stories. And so, it was something I'd always wanted to do. And when I was young, I read things like C.S. Lewis, Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, those kind of stories, Ursula Le Guin's Wizard of Earthsea, Lord of the Rings, a lot of fantasy stuff, but then also a lot of, as I got a little older, there wasn't really much of a young adult market in those days, so I would read a lot of mysteries, Agatha Christie, those kind of things, Sherlock Holmes, and these became, my little refuge, my sort of place to go, and so I always wanted to tell those kind of stories myself, so eventually I did.
Cool.
Yeah, definitely. Books are a very good way to escape reality, especially when the world can be so bleak. Especially how things have been with like COVID and everything. I know the world's recovering, but a lot of people have found comfort in books, and I definitely agree with your point. I've found comfort in many types of books. And mystery and books from C.S. Lewis, they're pretty good books to engulf yourself in the world, like The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. Definitely agree with that. Now, AJ, what is your thought process behind writing books? As we said before, you're an author, and you've written a plethora of books. So how do you go at writing a book? Do you sit down by your favorite tree and ponder?
I mean, the idea for a book can come from anywhere. Sometimes it'll just be, an idea about a character. Sometimes it'll be about a place, or it'll be a plot point, or a combination of things. Like, what if this happened in this kind of world, And that can come at any time and anywhere. Sometimes, literally, you wake up from a dream and think, oh, there might be something there. And then it sort of stews in your head. At least for me, there are lots of different ways to do this, but for me, it'll sort of sit around and percolate a little bit, and then I'll think, maybe there's a hook there, an idea. So the thing that sort of it makes me excited about exploring the story further, and then I'll start to ask key questions like, I have this core idea about a particular character in a particular world, and now I start asking the questions that I need to know about what's going on in this story and what might happen and the kind of things that might develop or complicate things. And as I start to do that, I'll start making notes, and jotting things down and start to build the beginnings of a kind of outline. And usually for me, an outline is going to be a sort of 10-page sketch that says, here's what I think this story is about. Here's where it starts. Here's where it finishes, probably. And here's some of the stuff that I know I'm going to go through to get to the end point, you know. And it's really loose, and it's really open to evolve and change. But then as I start to write, every time I decide to change my outline, or the story starts to go in a slightly different direction, I'll come back to that sketch and, you know, make sure that the story still works so that I don't paint myself into a corner and get stuck, you know. But once I get that outline, and usually I'll do that in a couple of weeks, just sort of thinking in bits and scribbling a few things down. But once I have that, then I think, okay, I think I have the beginnings of a story, and then I'll start to write. And once I've committed to it, I'll write 3 or 4 days a week, you know, depending on my schedule. And usually I can sort of bang out 3,000 words in a long morning, you know, first thing in the morning until sort of early afternoon. And if I can do that, if I shoot for about 10,000 words a week, then I can have a first draft done in about a month and a half, thereabouts. And I keep moving forward. I'm just sort of trying to develop the story, trying to push through to the end. And then, you know, it's not all going to be great, but if I can get to a complete point where I say, okay, first draft is done, then I've got something concrete to go back to and reread and start to see where the problems are, where the plot holes are, and what needs working. And, you know, and I'll take another month or so to turn that into a second draft. And then I'll start sharing it with people. If I think, you know, at that point, I'll reread the whole thing aloud to myself. And if I get to the end of it and feel like I have a story that's worth telling, then I'll start sharing it with a few people, family, friends who I trust, send it to my agent, and go from there.
Yeah, that definitely sounds like a very thorough thought process of going through a book. I know books take a lot of time to, you know, get through the motions of the ocean, so to speak, and get your ideas from your mind to paper. And it seems like you got a good system on that. You got a good handle on your book writing process. And if you ever need an extra pair of eyes, you know, Jack and I are here if you ever want to send us scripts for your books our way.
All right. Yeah, it's good to know.
So, AJ, can you describe the feeling you got when your first book got published?
Yeah, man. I mean, I wrote long fiction for 20 years before I got published. I wrote my first novel when I was like 19. And in those days, there was no such thing as like self-publishing, and there weren't a lot of really small presses. So you either got a big publisher or you got nothing. And so, you know, I was sort of banging out. I wrote like 8 complete novels before I got anything published. And so, you know, and it was weird because my agent called me and she's like, okay, and I could tell straight away that something good and weird had happened. And the good thing was that we sold the book. The weird thing was that we'd sold it in Greece, the country.
Wow.
Which, like, never happens, right? Usually what happens is you sell it in your own home market, which for me is the U.S. now, and then other publishers might get interested elsewhere in the world. But in this case, we sold it in Greece, and then we sold it, I think, in Indonesia, and, you know, it was weird. We sold it in a few foreign markets before we sold it in the U.S., and then that book sold in something like 28 languages. And it was wild, you know? And I remember when the book came out, and it was everywhere. And I mean, like, you know, not just your regular sort of Barnes & Noble bookstores and stuff, but it was in my grocery store and pharmacy. And I think actually the first copy I saw was in LAX at the airport in L.A. I was flying out there for something, and I saw it in the airport, and I just couldn't believe it, you know?
I mean, that's how you know you made it, when you see your book at an airport.
Yeah, really. And that's a really tough thing to get, especially now, because you know those bookstores carry like 10 books.
Yeah.
But yeah, it was wild, and it felt like something, you know, major had changed in my life, which in many ways it hadn't, but that's what it felt like at the time. And people were like, "Oh, you're an overnight success," and I was like, "Yeah, I've been doing this for 20 years, and I got nothing to show for it until today." So it was a really long night.
Yeah, definitely. I understand that. Did all of those other 8 books eventually get published, or are they still sitting in the back corners of your office?
There are a few that are still sitting around. There are a couple that I published after that. You know, and what's frustrating about this, about the business, is that, you know, what I won't say which, but one of the books that I published after the fact, you know, 20 years after I wrote it, was published by one of the companies that rejected it when I first submitted it to them.
Ain't that something? You know? Maybe they realized how successful you got and they wanted you back.
I mean, you know, they thought, oh, well, now he's successful, so maybe more people would be interested. Or, you know, maybe. And maybe the market had changed a little bit. I think that's also true. Sometimes you write a book and you feel good about it, but there's nothing like it in the marketplace, and sometimes that's a good thing, and sometimes it's not. Sometimes it takes... I can have a book sitting around for a while that no one's interested in, and then suddenly that kind of book is going to be... I mean, you know, the first one that I was talking about was a book called The Mask of Atreus, which I had written, and it was a sort of mystery thriller that had some archaeological components in it. Why did that book sell when none of the others had? Because The Da Vinci Code had just come out, and suddenly publishers wanted archaeological mysteries.
Well, I mean, at least you made the most of the situation. You got to change with the times, as they say. Got to keep up with,
yeah, exactly,
with what's relevant and hip with the kids, so to speak.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah, exactly.
Would you say that... it's been a lot easier to publish books just because you've had that name recognition? Do you have to, like, now you're so high and mighty that you have to pick what publisher you want, or is it still a struggle to get a book off the ground?
I think it's still a struggle. I think, you know, these days publishing is really sort of stressed. And a lot of the big companies have been sort of, you know, have combined, and they've been bought out by big, you know, what do you call them, sort of big multinational empire-type companies, and the demands, the expectations for profits have gone up. And I think that for most writers, that has been hard, because it means that the old days where you could produce a book and, you know, so long as it was sort of selling a little bit and such, everybody was happy, and now they're not. Now they're looking for every book to sell massively, and of course most books don't, which means that publishers are really, really cautious when they're picking up stuff, unless you're such a huge name, you know, that they think that just producing the book is going to make them a fortune. And not many people are in that boat. So, you know, I think that it's still hard. I have some publishers who I think will take... You know, I have one publisher who I submitted something to him not long ago, and I was like, "So what do you think? Do you think you're going to go for it?" And he's like, "Dude, I'd print your grocery list at this point." So, but you know, that's unusual, and, you know, I'm lucky in that respect. And that's a fairly small press. I think, you know, you're, as far as the big houses are concerned, it's always, "What have you done for me lately?"
Yeah, that's definitely an interesting business to be in. It sounds very cutthroat. Jack and I are not too familiar with it, but you're giving us a pretty in-depth insight, and our listeners, I'm sure they're enjoying that.
Hey, AJ, cool, have you ever dealt with the writer's block?
I can't afford it. you know, I mean, I think I have writer's block in the sense that I don't know what my next story is going to be. You know, and I sometimes have to sort of sit around and wait for that, wait for the idea that I'm really excited about. But once I've got that idea, I'm going to write the book, you know, unless I really get to a point as I'm writing it where I think, you know what, this just isn't that good, or the idea doesn't have the legs that I thought it did, and I might drop it. But that's really rare. If I believe in the project, I'm going to write it. And that's my job, you know. It's like, I mean, you wouldn't have a plumber come to your house to fix your sink or something, and halfway through the job, he says, "You know what? I'm just not feeling this. I'm going to go now." You know what I mean? It's like I think most serious writers, most professional writers, think that writer's block is an indulgence that we can't afford to have most of the time. You know?
Yeah.
So get on with it.
I mean, it's also a way to kind of make your mind think. The pressure of having writer's block can be infuriating at times. It's definitely happened to me every now and again. But to just get an idea to paper is always very satisfying when you're sitting looking at a blank screen or a blank piece of paper for hours upon hours, just trying to think of how to start the story.
Yeah. I think you have to give yourself permission to be crap. You know what I mean? You can't be a perfectionist about it. I mean, this is why, for me, I get that first draft down. And I'm not editing as I go. I don't keep going back and fixing stuff. I just keep moving. You know, I think writers are like sharks. You gotta keep moving or you drown. And I think that when you're doing that, you have to just sort of say, you know what? I know this bit isn't great, or I don't really know how this scene should work. I'll come back and fix that. But it's a hell of a lot easier to do that when you've got a complete manuscript that says the end. You know, as opposed to I keep revising the same chapter over and over and I'm not moving any further forward. So I think that people think about writing as if it's all art in this sort of slightly mystical sense. And I think there's value to that. But I think also you have to think of it like it's a craft, like you're building something, you know, and it's like you're building a cabinet or whatever. And that requires tools, and it requires pieces of equipment, and it requires techniques, and most things can be fixed. So I think that sometimes when people talk about writer's block, it gets a bit mystical and self-indulgent. And my attitude is, you're trying to build something, so figure out what you need to build and build it.
Yeah, definitely, AJ. Now, we've seen that you've written books with other authors, kind of like a co-writing process. Mm-hmm. Is that a lot different than writing a book on your own? I assume that you've had different ways of going at writing a book with somebody else on the steering wheel. You guys are sharing the wheel rather than you driving the car on your own, for lack of a better analogy.
Yeah. I mean, it is different. It depends on who you're writing with and what their process is. I've done a couple of books with a British mystery writer called David Hewson, and he's a writer like me, so he has his own method. But, you know, we sort of, in that case, we divided up which parts of the story we were going to tell. And then he's writing his pages and I'm writing my pages. And then we're just sort of sending them to each other and editing each other so that the whole thing then can come out with a single unified voice, you know. But that's because he was a novelist. If I'm writing with like Tom DeLonge from Blink 182, our jobs are really different. And he is firing ideas at me, and he's sending me research and sort of just sort of moments of inspiration and stuff. But I'm doing most of the sentence level writing, which I will then send to him, and he'll be like, "I like this. Maybe with this part, we can push this in a slightly different way." So our jobs are really different in that situation, and it's almost, I mean, it's not a solo project, but it, the actual sentence level writing part feels more like a solo project, because so long as I'm keeping him in the loop and he's sending me the ideas that he wants to incorporate, it's still me mostly doing the actual sit down typing. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it's like he's throwing clay at you and you're shaping it to be what he's expecting it to be molded into, right?
Yeah. And we talk a lot during the process. We're like constantly on the phone sometimes we'll get together in person and just sort of brainstorm, you know.
So, AJ, was there any advice given to you that made you approach your work differently? Or is there any advice you can offer to those who want to pursue a career as a writer?
I think some of what I was just saying about thinking of your writing as craft rather than mysticism or art can be really helpful, because it means that you focus on the nuts and bolts stuff, the mechanical stuff that you can take care of. And the biggest thing, I think, is that you, if you're interested in being a writer, you have to write all the time. you know, because that's how you learn. I've taught creative writing classes. I've never taken one. And, you know, I think what people need to learn is that most of what a writer needs is already inside them. And they just need to practice and practice and practice and read and read and read. You know, sometimes I'll meet young writers who say, oh, I'm working on such and such a thing. And I say, well, what's it like? And they say, well, it's not like anything. And I'm like, okay, so you've not done your research, because everything is like something. You know, there is no absolutely brand new story that nobody has ever told before. And if you think there is, it means you haven't read enough. And so I would say read everything, you know, whether it's high quality classic literature or pulp fiction or whatever, because you can usually find something in a published book that author is doing really well, and you can learn from that. And I tell my students all the time, you know, if you're really enjoying a book, or for that matter, a movie or a TV show, take a moment at some point to ask yourself why it's working. What is this thing doing that's keeping me up at night turning the pages or whatever? And how can I use that? How can I learn from that and incorporate it into my own work?
Yeah, and they say that to write good literature, you have to read good literature. And I mean, what you said pretty much sums up that ideology. And I can't help but agree with you on that.
Yeah, yeah.
I've been reading Secret Machines, just the first book so far. I'm about a third of the way through, and it's really enticing to go back every night and read it. I got to say that it's a lot of fun, and it was a big reason why we wanted you on the show. It really caught my attention, and I've really been enjoying it.
That's great. Thanks, man. I mean, it was an odd project, you know, obviously. When Tom and I were first talking about it, and he was saying, you know, well, I want this to sort of span all human history and all geography and all cultures and stuff. And I'm like, okay, I don't know how to do that. So we have to sort of sit down and figure out the architecture of the story so that it will feel unified. And if you're only a third in, you might not have noticed this yet, but you know, hopefully what you'll feel as you get further into the book is that it gets faster and tighter as the different storylines all start to come together to a point, so that instead of it feeling like four separate stories with a lot of little interludes and things scattered along the way, it's really one story.
Yeah, it's definitely good so far. I like the continuing stories spread throughout the chapters. I think it's a very interesting way to read a book. Definitely something that I'm not too familiar with, so it was a very breath of fresh air, so to speak, with how I went about reading it. Because I'm going in order, cool. Of course. I'm not just skipping around to continue the stories.
Yeah, cool. Good.
Now, just as for our listeners out there, AJ, where can we find you on any social medias? Are you around?
I'm around. I'm still on Twitter by the skin of my teeth. I'm on Facebook and Instagram. My website is ajhartley.net. That's the best place to go to sort of connect to everything else. I have a little YouTube channel where I talk mostly about music, and that's about it.
Awesome. Thanks a lot, AJ. And your books can be found on your website too, correct?
Yep, and Amazon and anywhere books are sold.
Awesome. I'll check the airports too, just for your books.
Yes.
Thanks so much for your time, AJ. We appreciate you joining us here on Future Talk. We'd love to have you again, and we appreciate your time.
My pleasure, guys. Thank you very much.
Thank you to all our listeners for listening to the segment with AJ. You can check him out with all his books, and see you guys after the break.